One of the tragedies that took place on Shavuos of Tammuz, first in the series, was the breaking of the luchos, the smashing of the tablets. Moshe Rabbeinu sees the Jews have created the Egel Azov, the golden calf, and he breaks the luchos. Medrash says that Moshe Rabbeinu was told on Har Sinai by the Ribbono Shel Olam that God told him pel peh, that ponim el ponim, in that unique nevuah that he had, that the Jews had created the Egel Azov, the golden calf. Yet Moshe Rabbeinu did not break the luchos until he descended from the har, from the mountain, down and saw for himself. He waited. And then we have a series of positions that explain this time gap, why he heard on top at the summit that the eagle had been created, but he did not break the luchos until he came down and saw for himself. The Medrash says that it's in order to be instructive, it's to teach a lesson for a dayan, for a judge, that whenever possible to see for himself, he should see for himself. And though here there was no question of credibility because he heard from God, and normally there would be the significance of substantiating through personally witnessing it, here there was no such necessity, but merely to be a model for future generations for judges to behave in that fashion where it would be necessary. The Netziv, early on in Bereishis, on the Posik, Vayas Hashem Vayar, each thing he made, he saw, he judged, he saw it was good. So the first time that it says, Vayar Hashem Ki Tov, and Rabbi Hashem saw that which he had created was good, says the Netziv, there is a reference that's reflexive here, that's a reference to the act of seeing. That seeing is tov. Why? Because the Ribbono Shel Olam has incorporated into the sense of vision that we are emotionally impacted by that which we witness visually. As evidence of this, says the Netziv, Moshe Rabbeinu heard from the Ribbono Shel Olam that the eagle had been created, but postpones, waits to act until he sees for himself. And that brings the hitpalut, it brings to a sense of internalizing hitpalut, an emotional response, integrating it within one's person. And therefore Moshe breaks the luchos. That's not like the Medrash. One could make the case that the Medrash does not go that route because Aspakalya Meira, the level of Nevuah that Moshe Rabbeinu witnessed, experienced, was fundamentally different than any other Nevuah, and is the equivalent of actually experiencing it. That's a possibility, and I'd like to submit some support for that. But let's leave that for a moment. So we have the Netziv, we have the Medrash. The Sfona says that Moshe Rabbeinu on Sinai was given the data, the information that they had created an eagle. But only later, when he saw for himself, he saw that they were engaged, involved in the whole process. B'simcha, b'tupim, m'chaylas, they were singing, dancing. And once something is being experienced with simcha, in order to be extricated from that person, because simcha integrates it, it becomes part of the person. And in order to now expunge it, Moshe Rabbeinu had to break the luchas. Again, what we have in the Sfaranos, there seem to be two stages. That on Sinai, there was missing this piece of information, or at least experientially, the impact until he saw for himself, which is somewhere perhaps in between the idea that he knew it all and understood it all, but and this piece of information was missing, but it would seem to differentiate between what happened on Sinai and what he saw later, which would make a differentiation between Aspakalia Meira and witnessing for oneself. So the Sforno would seem to line up close to the Netziv. There's a Chsam Sefer. Chsam Sefer is not addressing this question. The Chsam Sefer quotes a Medrash in Parshas Dvor. Eilo Advor, Mashadiber, Moshe, El Kol Yisrael, Bebelan. This is admonishment. Teichacho. Moshe Rabbeinu waits till coming close to his demise, to his Petira, in order to give Teichacho, admonishment, deprecation to Klal Yisrael. Why? Because we have a principle that the older somebody is, when he gives the teichacha, the more credibility he has. Because he's less suspect of having an agenda, and he's closer to his own din v'cheshvin. So the longer it's postponed, doesn't mean you can always postpone it, but theoretically, if one has a choice, it's better that the one who's giving the mochiach, the one who's giving the teichacha, the admonishment, should be older. Moshe Rabbeinu waits. And then he gives a list of the times that he had, he gives a review, a summary. I had to do this, and I had to do that. And this took place in Eivra Yarden, Bamidbar, Barova, in the plains, Mol Sof, near Sof. Opposites of Bein Poran and Bein Tova, the Lovon, the Chatzeros, the Dizov. Whole list of locations. What do I need all this geography for? So asks the Medrash in Dvarav. What's the point of all this extra information? There's no such thing as extra information. Everything in Torah is vital and instructive. Says the Medrash, since Moshe Rabbeinu waited to give the primary teichacha, summary, he did respond at different occasions when he had to, but the primary teichacha is now, before he's going to leave this worldly existence. So why did he do that? As we said, there's the upside. What's the upside? More credibility, less suspect of having an agenda. But there's a downside. What's the downside? Maybe the people who are being corrected will say, he's old, senile, he's not with it anymore. He's out of it. They could use that as a rationalization. So Moshe Rabbeinu is anticipating that problem, and he cites every geographic locale where they sinned, sometimes He responded to a certain extent, sometimes he postponed it, but the major Teichacho is going to be now, and he cites every one of those venues where they, in fact, breached their obligations to HaKadosh Baruch Hu and the covenant that they had accepted from the Ovis, then Maimel HaSinai, v'chulu v'chulu. So that's the reason for mentioning all of the geography. Why? To show you that he's clear. He remembers. He's not senile. He's functioning, he's performing. His faculties are in order. That's the Medrash. Ask the Ksam Sefer. We have explicit verses later on, towards the end of Sefer Dvarim, that lo nos lechoi v'lo kea enoi, that Moshe Rabbeinu physically was in top shape. What he saw, his demeanor, his everything about him, physiologically, was in order, and implied in what the Chassam Sefer, the way he asks it, is that it must have been evident. If the Pasuk states it as a flat-out statement, in fact, it must have been noticeable. So where's the Havamina? How could they come along and say that, well, he's an old man and he doesn't know what he's saying? There's no kasha. And if there's no kasha, that had to be anticipated, then there's no point in bringing the geography. Then the kasha, the question of the Medrash comes back. Again, what were our steps? Moshe Rabbeinu cites the geography. The Medrash says, why did he cite the geography? You know why? Because he waited to give Teichacho, to give the admonishment, the deprecation till the end. And therefore they might say, well, he wasn't really with it. Says the Chassam Sefer, but they couldn't have said that because it was clearly evident that he was with it physically in top form. So now the Chassam Sefer has the problem to reconcile the question and answer of the Medrash. Says the Chassam Sefer, there's a machlekes between the Babli and the Yerushalmi about the surrounding of the city. Another tragedy that took place on Shivosa Batamuz, whether that happened in Bayis Rishon on Tes Batamuz or Yud Zayin Tamuz. Pasuk and Yom Yom says it happened Tes. We fast Yud Zayin because that's Bayis Sheni, the second temple. And that's closer to us historically, and therefore we relate to that tragedy as being most recent. It's brought, the tour brings, Tur Shulchan Aruch brings, that in fact a Bal Nefesh, somebody who is wants to be more deeply connected to our history, our mission, who we are, will also fast on Tes. But we don't have a takona, a gzera, from the whole tzibur, because they're two close Tes, the 9th and the 17th. That's the Babli. Tosfos quotes the Yerushalmi. The Yerushalmi says, in fact, in Bayis Rishon was also on Yud Zayin. And Kilkul Cheshbonos Haya Kan. They were confused. The chaos that was precipitated by the destruction, by the suffering, the loss of life, was so overwhelming that they lost their records. They were totally confused as to the dating. The way I understand, the way the Chassam Sefer understands it, is that, but it's a posik, the Novi says, Tess, is that the Novi was commanded by HaKadosh Baruch Hu to write it down as per the mistake. Because that would be a barometer, an indication for future generations, that even somebody of the caliber of Yirmiyahu HaNovi could get confused as a citizen, as a ezrach min haminyan. But at the moment of truth, the Rebbeinu Shlom, Nevuah, he knows what the truth is. But the Rebbeinu Shlom says, commit it to posterity according to the mistake. How do we know that it in fact was Yud Zayin? That we have a Maseiros, we have a tradition that was passed down that verifies in fact it was Yud Zayin. And that was passed down, Deire Deiris, and we know that to be the fact, though the Pasuk says, Tes. Ask some Sefer, why, lefi the Yerushalmi, according to Yerushalmi, Yirmiyahu HaNavi, we're told, as an Ezach min haminyan, gets overwhelmed. Moshe Rabbeinu, Chazal teach us, witnessed every tragedy that would ever befall Klal Yisrael. Ad ha-yam ha-achron, ad ha-yom ha-achron. He saw each of the churbanos, not one, he saw two. And every other pogrom, inquisition, holocaust. Moshe Rabbeinu saw it all till the end of time. Ask the Chasam Sefer, how come Moshe Rabbeinu didn't get confused? We have no record of him getting confused. How come Yirmiyahu did get confused and Moshe Rabbeinu did not get confused? Answers the Chasam Sefer, Moshe Rabbeinu also saw the Gula. He saw the ultimate redemption. He saw the light at the other end of the tunnel. Yirmiyahu knew that there would be, subscribe to that proposition, Mashiach is going to come, there'll be an ultimate gula, but he didn't witness it. Moshe Rabbeinu, just like he witnessed the Tzaras, suffering, he also witnessed the ultimate redemption, the Gula. Now, one could ask that there was an alternative resolution answer that the Chasam Sefer might have given. Chasam Sefer could have said, and it seemed to me that perhaps that's more direct, would be to say there's a fundamental difference between Moshe Rabbeinu and Yirmiyahu. Yirmiyahu's living through it. Yirmiyahu choshet el psoroi. He's living through it. Moshe Rabbeinu, as it were, only witnessed it, experienced it virtually. He saw it in Nevuah. So maybe when you live through it, you get confused. And when you only see it through Nevuah, you don't get confused. The Chasam Sefer does not give that answer. He skips over that possibility, which I must assume he considered. And he goes to the alternative to say, you know what the difference is between Yirmiyahu and Moshe Rabbeinu? Moshe Rabbeinu saw the Geula, he saw the ultimate redemption. Yirmiyahu did not. That's the difference. Which implied then, in what the Chasam Sefer is saying, is that there is no, since he skipped over the alternative of differentiating between actually experiencing it and merely seeing it by Nevuah, even though it was Asplakalya Meira, it was that level of Nevuah of Moshe Rabbeinu. On the contrary, because it's Asparkalya Meira. Once it's Asparkalya Meira, the Chasam Sefer seems to be assuming and positing that it's the equivalent of living through it. There's no difference. if, and it does seem that the Chassam Sefer understands it that way, if that's in fact the case, then he would disagree with the Netziv. The Netziv differentiates, if you remember, the Rebbeinu Shem saw, he put into vision something that isn't elsewhere. What? That witnessing something, seeing it, brings to his spilus, brings to internalization. And since that is in fact, brings you to act, that's the spilus. So there's a difference between seeing and what did the Netziv submit? As evidence, the Moshe Rabbeinu does not break the luchos on Har Sinai. He waits till he comes down. Why? Because it brought to his spilus when he witnessed it. The Chassam Sefer would not accept that. Because Aspaka Yamir is the equivalent. Otherwise, the Chassam Sefer didn't have to go looking for the other teretz to differentiate between Moshe and Yamiyahu. In fact, I saw a Reb Moshe Feinstein. Zecher Tzadik Lavracha has a tshuva on, very interesting tshuva on Bika Cholim over the telephone. And we won't get into all of that now, but somebody who's writing the tshuva to him, the question, the shaila, quotes the Sefer Ikrim, where the Sefer Ikrim says something similar about being present, the impact that it has, as opposed to only hearing about something. And Moshe Feinstein, very, very, very boldly says that it's unacceptable to make such a differentiation, even though it's the Sefer Ikrim that does make that differentiation. He very boldly says that when you're talking about Aspaka Yamira, it's in a different league. That's the equivalent of witnessing and experiencing it. Okay, so we're back to the problem then. So let's say that we're not going with the Netziv. We don't go with the Netziv, then why did Moshe Rabbeinu wait? Well, then we had the Sforna, who said that Moshe Rabbeinu was missing one piece of information, that they were doing it with Simcha. But that's also unacceptable if you think that Aspaka Yamira is existentially, qualitatively identical. It's not, nothing is missing. So then Simcha should have been there too. So then you're left with the Medrash. And the Medrash said, Moshe Rabbeinu had it all. He knew it all and said he could have, might have broken the Luchas up on top of Sinai. Nothing was missing. Why did he wait? To be instructive, to teach a judge, a dayan, a shofet for future generations. Did he have to wait? No. But he did it as a pedagogic act merely for future generations. We have such a concept. We have that in the posek Na'ase Odom. The Rebbeinu Shlom consults with the Beis Din Shalmala. Does the Rebbeinu Shlom have to consult? No. It's an exercise that purely is educational in order to instruct future generations. So Moshe Rabbeinu does the same thing. So that's one possibility. Another possibility. Rameya Simcha is not addressing this question of why Moshe Rabbeinu waited the lapse of time from on top of Sinai to coming down. Not his issue. What is he addressing? Why did Moshe Rabbeinu break the luchos? We're not saying it's out of exasperation and frustration and venting his spleen, because it's Moshe Rabbeinu. It's a different league. What he did was intentional, was for Deiris, and had to be done. It's with a cheshbon. Says Rameya Simcha, that if we go back, take a look at the Rambam says the fundamental mistake of the idolaters, the Evdei Avodah Zarah, was that they thought of the deity, they thought of the creator, they extrapolated from the human condition and transmitted it as limitations to the divine mind. And just like a CEO, chief executive officer of a major corporation, he needs department heads. And therefore he gives each one a certain amount of autonomy, and he gives what certain amount to perform. Then whoever's doing business with that corporation comes to a point that he realizes that since these executives have a certain amount of latitude, it's very, very propitious, it's worthwhile to ingratiate oneself with these department heads. So it wasn't that they had a mistake whether or not there was a creator, a God that created it all. But thinking in anthropomorphic terms, they extended that human limitation, as it were, to the deity. And then it gradually got worse and worse, and they began only to relate to the executive. Rooted there is an assumption that something in the material world is self-propelled, self-justifying in its own existence, and is autonomous in its own spirituality. At the moment that the luchos exist, Moshe Rabbeinu receives a little bit. There's nothing in the material world that is holier than these luchos. The letters hold together miraculously. The first luchos were carved by the Ribbono Shel Olam, as it were. So it's the epitome of spirituality are these stone tablets. What better way to rebut, to be mafrich, to rebut this premise that something in the physical universe can be self-justifying in its own existence and in its own spirituality, which the two interlock, they overlap. What better way than to break the luchos? These luchos, which are so holy, so extraordinary, so unique, Moshe Rabbeinu says, wants to put to rest this thesis for once and for all. It's not true. It's only to the extent that the Ribbono Shel Olam awards something Kedusha, re-awards it, and re-awards it, and reassigns it, and reassigns it. If the Isis, the letters, are going to take off, then this loses its sanctity, these tablets. And so Moshe Rabbeinu is breaking the luchos as a didactic act. He's teaching Klal Yisrael a lesson. Not the lesson that we heard from the Medrash about a judge waiting, a different lesson. What's the lesson? To be mafrich, to rebut the root premise of Avodah Zarah, of idolatry. If that is the lesson that Moshe Rabbeinu has decided to teach Klal Yisrael, who has to witness it? Klal Yisrael has to witness it. They have to witness it. So for Moshe Rabbeinu, there's no difference between what he heard on Sinai and then what he later witnessed when he came down. Meir Simcha doesn't take it this next step because that's not his question. But we can take it that next step. The next step is that Moshe Rabbeinu saw it all. He knew it was B'Simcha. He had the Hispilus, he had internalized it. It was all there. But he set himself a goal. What is the goal? To teach a lesson, to give a shiur to Klal Yisrael. Who has to witness it then? Klal Yisrael. For them, the premise of the difference between merely hearing about it and seeing it is fundamentally true. It's all the difference in the world. If they would have heard he broke the luchos on Sinai, not witnessed it, not being impacted by it, then it wouldn't have had that effect upon them. If I'm not mistaken, Ramesha Feinstein also touches on this. And so, we're left with two possibilities of why Moshe Rabbeinu waits. One possibility is that he's waiting, as the Medrash said, to be instructive about witnessing, if you can witness. The second is the teichecho that Moshe Rabbeinu wanted to dramatize, to put in front of Klal Yisrael that they should feel it, not just know about it. For them, it would be a difference. Moshe Rabbeinu, aspaka yamila, same level. Okay, so Shiva also the Tamuz, the breaking into the city, according to the Yerushalmi, both happened on Yud Zayin, by Yisrishan and by Yisheni. The Babli, two different dates, as recorded in the Novi. How do we explain the fact that the Novi wrote down the wrong date? As we said, that the Rebbeinu Shlom told the Novi in the moment of truth, yes, that is the wrong date, write it down accordingly. Because that's my message, that even somebody of the caliber of a Yirmiyahu up till the moment of Nevuah could have it wrong, and then we're going to eternalize that for days. Klal Yisrael commemorate the Yud Zayin Nitzbruch, Shulchan Aruch, the tour that Bali Nefesh will fast on Tess as well. But this encirclement of the city, the breaking of the Luchas, echo, as do the other tragedies listed in the Mishnah, echo through the generations. And we live with them. Extraordinary providence of days being set aside as resources for positive or retributional purposes, again and again revisited in Jewish history. I'll end with this. We're living very, very challenging times. I remember that during the, I believe it was the first Gulf War, we asked Rav Shach, we asked Zecher Tzadik L'Vracha, we asked Rav Shlomo Zalman, different people from the staff, Zecher Tzadik L'Vracha, whether or not people should stay or they should leave if they're frightened, under pressure. Each one of them said, have to stay with the tzibur at a time that a tzibur is under pressure. There are, can be mitigating circumstances, somebody's mother, father, in a state of such hysterical panic that there's a threat to their health. Could be a hetter. But Rav Shach added one thing, he added one point. Don't ever think, if such a person does utilize that heta, that he won't be paying a penalty for missing the elevation that a tzibur has when they're under pressure. There's an aliyah that a tzibur has and a growth that you can't simulate that. You can hear about it from a distance, but for us, we don't enjoy Aspakaya Meira individually or collectively today. So experiencing it is one reality. Hearing about it is another reality. It's true. Klach, klal zeh biyodcha. Anything that we teach or share with our Talmidim, potential Talmidim, Mekurovim, in the act of Kiruv, there is a primary difference between imparting information or helping that information become experiential, helping it become to life. It's not bechinam that the brocha is la'asek, to be engaged with divrei Torah. Engaged means helping it become internalized and living it. It's kihem chayenu. Finally, according to Moshe, I guess it was about 30 years ago, a little less than 30 years ago, there was a secular Jewish scholar that passed away here. He was on the faculty of the university and was very well known in the world and well respected. And leading newspapers chastised, they gave teichocha to the Israeli community because very few people turned out to the funeral. The world-renowned academic, how can so few people show up? Some years after that, the Havdil, Reb Moshe, this Reb Moshe who I quoted, right? He was Niftan, he was brought here for Kvura on the most difficult day of the year that it is possible to make a levaya. It was Shushan Purim. Reb Moshe didn't live in Eretz Yisrael. I don't know, maybe one time visited. Then the tzibur, long time ago, over 25 years ago, the tzibur was much smaller than it is today, but somewhere between 250,000 and 350,000 people showed up for the levaya. So how can that be that somebody who lived here, a renowned local personality, was pretty much ignored? And Lahavdil, a Jew that lived in a small apartment on the east side of Manhattan, comes here, and so many people interrupt their Purim Suda to participate in the Levaya. Ki hem chayenu, ve'yoch yameinu. It's a living reality. And that living reality means that we have to bridge, if we're trying to communicate the Torah experience, we have to bridge between information and internalization. And as much as possible, share this flow, idea, to discussion, to experience. Chavrusa, mishpocha, communities. It works. And only by demonstrating it are we going to get to where we have to be. Baruch Hashem should give us all easy tzom, and we should witness the Bias Gvel b'mehera b'yameinu.